God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. I hope those words from Psalm 46 are an encouragement to you as we begin this strange time of meeting together through YouTube. We're looking forward to spending some time hearing from God's word, praying together and singing together. And even though we're apart in body, we are united in spirit, one in the Lord Jesus Christ. I know it's going to be strange, but it's important that we spend this time focusing our hearts on God. And so as we begin, let's pray and ask for his help. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are with us. And through all the strange oddities of the previous few days, we thank you that we know your presence with us now. You are our fortress. And as we feel the earth giving way and the nations in uproar because of everything that's happening around us, help us to trust that you will be our fortress. Help us to be confident that if we are with you, we will not fall. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, as I say, we're going to pray and sing and read God's word and hear it taught. The next thing we're going to do now is to sing a song. The words are going to appear on the screen for you and there'll be a backing track in the background. Don't feel embarrassment to sit at your homes around your screens and sing together. It's great for us to lift our voices together, even if we're apart. So let's together lift our voices in praise to God. How deep the Father's love for us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretched treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was a post. trust in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. I paid my ransom.
Well, in all the drama of what's happened this week, there's a chance that we might have forgotten that today is Mothering Sunday. A chance for us to give thanks to God for our mums and those ladies in the church who have mothered us and cared for us. And we give thanks to God every year for the women of the church and the vital role that they play. We thank God for the gifts He's given to them. And so as we come now to a time of prayer, we're not just going to pray for the things that are going on in our world. We're going to pray with thankfulness as well. Thankful for the people that God has put in our lives. Thankful for those who God has allowed to help us. So let's turn and spend some time in prayer. We're going to pray for Mothering Sunday. We are going to pray for the situation around coronavirus and ask that God would be helping those in charge of sorting that out. So let's spend some time now in prayer. Loving God, our Heavenly Father, You love us with an undying love. You care for us in sending Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank You that You are the giver of every good and perfect gift that comes from heaven above. And on this Mothering Sunday, we give You thanks for our mums. Lord, thank You not just for our biological mothers, but for all those women who have played a role in our lives in raising us to be the people we are today. Lord, thank You that they are a gift from You. Lord, for those of us who are feeling sad today, grieving the mothers who aren't with us, or mothers who weren't what they could be to us, Lord, thank You that You care for us. You gather us like a mother hen gathers her chicks under Your wing. For Lord, those who perhaps would long to be mothers and feel the grief of loss in that way, Lord, we pray that as a church family, we would know the joy of loving and caring for one another in a way that is unique because of the way You've gathered us in Jesus. And so, Lord, help us to be filled with thankfulness today for the good gift of mothers. Amen. Father, we continue in prayer for the ongoing situation that we are facing as a church right now, as a nation and as a world. Lord, it grieves us to be separated on Your day. When we should be together celebrating, we are separated by distance. When we should be seeing one another face to face, we are parted. Lord, we pray that that would help us grow in our longing for the new creation. Fix in us that hope of the everlasting life that is ours in Christ Jesus. And Lord, as we long to be gathered together with friends and family once more, help us even more to long for that day when we are gathered with the Lord Jesus and see Him face to face with a great multitude that no one can count. Thank You that in Christ our hope is secure for the future. And we pray that in the words of the psalm we read earlier, we would not fear because we know that You are with us. Lord, we pray for those who are feeling anxious because of health conditions, because of being isolated. Lord, comfort them. Give them peace. Free them from anxiety. Lord, we pray for those who are concerned about the lack of food and the inability to get out of the house. Help us as a church family to love and care for one another, to serve one another as you have served us. And Lord, we pray for those who are making the big decisions about what needs to happen next. We pray for our government, for Boris Johnson and his advisors. Lord, please grant them great wisdom in knowing what steps are the right ones to take so that this crisis would be ended as soon as possible. Lord, we particularly pray that they would care for the vulnerable in our society. Lord, for those who are out of pocket because work has ended. For those who are additionally stressed because the extra pressure of work on them in the NHS or teachers. Lord, we particularly commit to you, Nick and his staff. Lord, give them grace and wisdom as they continue to open next week. Pray for all teachers as they face that pressure of additional lessons. Lord, thank you that you strengthen us. Thank you that when we ask for wisdom, you grant it. And Lord, we pray that we would remember that you are working in all things for our good if we love you. And so we ask that we would have confidence that your good plan is being worked out despite the fear and panic that surrounds us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In a moment, we're going to have a change of scene as Dan brings us God's word. He'll be speaking from Oak Hill Chapel, recorded earlier in the week. And after we've done that, we'll have a chance to sing one final song. But as you sit there in your homes, do have your Bibles open in front of you. Kids, if you want to have a notebook or something to write down your ideas, in the coming weeks we're hoping to have some worksheets for you to help you follow along with what we're doing. But we want to pray that we would learn just as much through watching a video as we normally meet when we are together in person at church. And so if you need to pause the video halfway through to just take a breather to make sure you're paying attention and listening, do that. If you want to just sit and listen, then do that too. If you're better off just closing your eyes and listening to the audio, well, do that as well. This won't ever be the same as being together in church, but by God's grace, it will help us to continue to put our trust in him. So until we meet again, goodbye.
Well, this is all a bit strange, isn't it? Except not really. God has not changed one bit since Boris Johnson's announcement on Monday. Although it's very, very weird preaching in a chapel with three kind people who are here with me. We are still the church and we are still God's people, even if we're not in the building that we're normally used to. So as we would any other Sunday, let's pray together. Father, I pray as each of us hears your Son, our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, speak this morning, we will be left responding like the psalmist. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. In his precious name we pray. Amen. Well, by God's kind and thoughtful providence, of all the sermon series we could be in at the moment, we are in Matthew chapter 18, which is a chapter all about the church, all about how the Christian community should think about each other, relate to each other, and as we will see especially today, care for each other. That's a pretty timely thing to be hearing, isn't it? So as we would any other week, let's read Matthew 18, 10 to 14. Go get your Bible. Seriously. Can wait as long as you. Or if you haven't got it, press pause. Right, Matthew 18, with everyone in front, with the Bible in front of them. Matthew 18, we're at verse 10, and I'll read verse 10 to 14. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go to look for the one that wandered off? And if he finds it, truly I tell you, he is happier about that one sheep than about the 99 that did not wander off. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should perish. Let me ask you just a question before we go any further, which I guess is going to have to be rhetorical. What would you say lies at the heart of our relationships with one another at church? What lies at the heart of our relationships with one another? And my guess is that will look different Sunday to Sunday. So sometimes really small things will lie at the heart of our relationships, the reaction we have to what someone is wearing or to what someone says, or how they respond to us when we ask them a question. Sometimes it will be bigger things. Sometimes we will just be so preoccupied with ourselves, and our reputation will be at the heart of our relationships with each other. So we'll want to come off as really impressive. We want to be liked as we go into church. Or sometimes it will be a vulnerability. And we come into church and we're coming with heavy guilt or with exhaustion and tiredness. Now, of course, this question of what lies at the heart of our relationships with one another is what lies at the heart of Matthew 18, which is all about the church. And right in the middle of this chapter, Jesus gives us, if you like, that the motivation, the foundation, the heartbeat for our relationships with each other. And it is this. At the heart of our attitude and relationships with each other should be our Heavenly Father's heart. If you're taking notes, you might want to write that down. At the heart of our attitude and relationships with each other should be our Heavenly Father's heart. So let's unpack what does that actually mean? So firstly, in our relationships with each other, understand your Heavenly Father's heart. Understand your Heavenly Father's heart. Have a look down. In the middle of this passage, Jesus asks his disciples a question. Do you see in verse 12? What do you think? What do you think? And you can imagine, can't you, the disciples are with Jesus in Capernaum. They're lying back on the grass on a hill, and they sort of sit back and start reflecting as Jesus begins this story, this parable. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, and hang on a second, and your head slightly rises from the grass, and you're having one of those, I'm sure I've heard this before moment. This parable sounds a little bit familiar, doesn't it? And that's because it is. In Luke 15, Jesus also tells the parable of the lost sheep, though interestingly to a different audience, Pharisees rather than disciples, and interestingly with a slightly different point. In Luke, the sheep is lost and outside the flock, and here it is wandering from within the flock. All of that says, basically, Jesus is just reusing rich and good material for different occasions, which is good news if you're a preacher. Hey, Stewie. Right, back to the parable. If one man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away. So who is this man? Who is this man? And who is this sheep? Well, the sheep must be one of these little ones that Jesus mentions in verse 10 and verse 14. And we know that one of these little ones doesn't just refer to little children. It is a term that Jesus uses, and you can see it in verse 6, do you see, to describe those who follow him. So that's what the sheep is. What about the man? What about the man who owns the sheep? Who is that? Well, the most obvious answer is it is our Heavenly Father. It is God himself, because you see in verse 14, that is who the man in the parable is compared to. And that makes sense. Throughout the Old Testament, there's rich language about God being a shepherd. And if you turn to Ezekiel 34, verse 11, God says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. And come to think of it, Jesus calls himself the good shepherd, doesn't he? So to some extent, this also is about Jesus. In fact, you might in your Bible have a little footnote that some of the early manuscripts of this verse had Luke 19, verse 10 in this chapter, which says the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. And you can see why people would have put it there. So there you go. We're clearer on who the people are in this parable. So back we go. We haven't actually heard the question yet. Here's the question. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go to look for the one that wandered off? That's our question. Now, I want to show you two amazing things about this question. And I'm going to level with you. The first will not seem amazing immediately, but stick with me. Some of you might know that I'm studying theology at Oak Hill at the moment. We are actually in Oak Hill Chapel at the moment, and I'm taking advantage of everyone not being in it to use it to record the sermon for you on Sunday morning. Now, one of my modules at Oak Hill College is New Testament Greek. I know, right? What a waste of time until now. You see, in the original Greek that Luke was written to, I've become that person now. In the original Greek, something called a slanted question is used in verse 12. What's a slanted question? It's a really clever thing, because basically a slanted question is a question that anticipates, that demands a certain answer. For example, surely you don't actually think that New Testament Greek is useful, do you? That is a slanted question. It anticipates, it demands the answer, no. And the way you know which answer, yes or no, is anticipated is based on the word that's used at the beginning of the sentence. One word means the question anticipates the answer, yes, of course. The other word anticipates the answer, no, of course not. Now, which word, guess which word, is used here in verse 12? It is the word that anticipates the answer, yes, of course. Now, if you switched off, back with me. Here's why all of that matters, because this is how you should read verse 12. This is how you should read verse 12. If our Heavenly Father sees one of his children wandering off, he will surely, without hesitation, go and look for the one that wanders off. What a glimpse that is into the Father's heart. Of course he does. It's never in doubt. He's not weighing up his options. He's not thinking, do I have time? He's not thinking, is this person worth going after? Of course he does. Of course he goes after them. Understand the Father's heart. Which leads us to a second amazing thing about this question, that the answer is yes. What do you think? What was your answer to this question? Because honestly, if I think about that question about going after the one sheep, I'm not sure I'd be so quick to say yes. Here's how I would react. Here's a glimpse of my heart. I think I'd be saying something like, I've got 99 safely tucked away here. What's one wandering sheep? And to be honest, it was his silly fault anyway for wandering off. What's the worst that's going to happen? I'm sure they'll make their own way back. All of those things would be my reaction. And you want to know why that reaction matters? That reaction reveals what is at the heart of my attitude towards my fellow brothers and sisters. And here's the point. It is completely at odds with the Father's heart. Understand the Father's heart. And when I understand the Father's heart, if I'm honest, I'm stunned. I'm stunned and I am touched by the tenderness and concern my Heavenly Father's heart has towards his children, towards me. Do I really think that I'm not like one of those lost sheep wandering off? Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the one I love. And what joy, what comfort that my Father's heart does not look with hardness at me, does not shrug his shoulders at me, does not wait for me to sort myself out, but goes after me. And verse 14 spells out why. Look down with me at verse 14. He is not willing that any of these little ones, these sheep, these followers of Jesus, should perish. Just read that verse again. Is there anything that surprises you? Why does Jesus use the word perish? Why does he use the word perish? Because I thought we were just talking about, you know, someone wandering off, a bad GPS, someone walking on the wrong side of the field when going for a walk. And surely that's the point. My attitude towards those wandering off is often flippant because I don't take seriously what is going on. But my Heavenly Father does. My Heavenly Father values so greatly his relationship with us, is so aware of the sin that so easily entangles us, that without any hesitation he goes after the sheep because he knows where wandering can end. Understand the Father's heart. Back to the parable we left behind, verse 13. What happens? What happens when the shepherd, when the father finds this sheep, this believer of Jesus? Well, verse 13 tells us, do you see? He is happier about that one sheep than about the 99 that did not wander off. Is Jesus saying that the other 99 sheep don't matter? That he doesn't care about them? I don't think so. I don't think he's making a statement about the father's lack of care of the 99. I think he's just making a statement of just how precious, just how much of a joy it is that one who was straying has now returned. I don't know about you, but sometimes I find it hard to imagine or think of that the creator of the universe, the almighty God, the eternal God, Father, Son, and Spirit, having any kind of tenderness or care towards me or his church. And this passage helps me with that. Understand the Father's heart. So far, we've been looking at the Father's heart to make sure that we understand how he views his people, how he views his church. But now we need to reconnect with the wider purpose of Matthew 18. Because Jesus didn't include these verses just so that we can understand the Father's heart, but so that we can emulate the Father's heart, so that we can reflect it in our relationships with one another. So what does that look like? What does that mean? Particularly in these times, to have the Father's heart at the heart of our relationships with one another. What does that mean? Three things. Firstly, it means not looking down on each other. Do you see how Jesus starts this little section, verse 10? Do not despise one of these little ones. Or you might not have in your translation, in your Bible, do not look down at these little ones, which is a really annoying thing if you ask someone to look down at verse 10. But anyway, that's actually a really good translation of the word, because the word is getting at someone who's looking down, someone who's shown contempt or scorn of someone. And of course, our instinctive reaction is to say, well, I'm not someone who despises or shows contempt or looks down on others at church. Are we sure? What about when we get frustrated because someone doesn't understand something that we think is really obvious in the Bible? What about when we think they're not the kind of Christian I want to be close friends with, or that I'd want my friends to meet? What about when we secretly in our hearts mock someone for the way they dress, the way they speak? Or what about when we look in disapproval at someone's lifestyle? Or think even what might be going on when we notice, oh, so-and-so isn't at church or fellowship group again. The trouble is, we are really, really good at disguising our contempt as concern. Now, don't mishear me. This passage is not saying we shouldn't be concerned about what our brothers and sisters are or are not doing. And we will see that in a moment. But we need to realize there is a fine line between contempt and concern when it comes to our relationships with one another. And only one of those things is shaped by the Father's heart. And there is a fine line between looking down at someone and looking out for someone, and only one of them is shaped by the Father's heart. And when we're tempted to just stray over that line, well, remember verse 11. Look at what verse 11 says. For I tell you that these people who we are tempted to look down on, despise, I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. Now, exactly what these angels are, no one seems able to agree on. So some people think it is some kind of personal guardian angel, but the rest of the Bible doesn't quite seem to support that, and what are they doing in heaven if they're meant to be guarding people on earth? And so some people say, well, okay, maybe they're not personal guardian angels. Maybe that these are sort of future spirits of Christians before God after they die. But if that's the case, well, why does Jesus use the present tense of always see rather than will always see? And ultimately, I don't think we can know exactly from these verses what these angels are. And ultimately, I don't think that matters. Because who they are is not the main point. They are mentioned to underline that every believer on earth, every brother and sister that you sit next to each Sunday, in the most intimate way is of concern in the heavenly realms to our Heavenly Father. Emulate the Father's heart. Do not despise one another. And secondly, it means that individuals matter. To emulate our Father's hearts in our relationships with one another means individuals matter. Did you notice just how much the word one is used in this passage? I'm going to read it super fast. Chapter 18, verse 10 to 14, and just try and count how many times you see the word one. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go back to look for the one that wandered off? And if he finds it, truly I tell you, he is happier about that one sheep than about the 99 that did not wander off. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any / one of these little ones should perish. I wasn't counting because I was speaking too quickly. But one comes again and again and again in this passage, and it's impossible to miss the point that individuals matter to our Heavenly Father, and so individuals should matter in our church community. So here's the question I think we should ask ourselves, and it is especially important right now. When it comes to our relationships with each other, are we just part of the church's life? Or are we part of individuals' lives? Are we just part of the church's life, or are we part of individuals' lives? Here's what I mean. It can be easy to see church as doing church activities. I go on Sunday to church. I go on Tuesday to the fellowship group. I'm part of Bushell Park Community Church, without really seeing myself as being part of individuals' lives, talking to individuals, listening to individuals. I mean, properly listening to individuals so that you remember individuals and what is going on in their lives. Now, that might seem a little bit intimidating to have that kind of level of relationship, but actually it's a beautiful thing, isn't it? It's a meaningful thing that I'm not just part of the life of Bushell Park. I'm part of the life of Stewie, of Molly, of Nicola, of Nick, of Eleanor, of Santi, or anyone else who's listening to this. Emulate your Father's heart, and your relationships with one another, individuals, matter. And thirdly, as we emulate our Father's heart, and we'll finish with this, it means pastoral care matters. In your relationships with one another, as you emulate your Father's hearts, do not despise one another. Individuals matter, and pastoral care matters. Have a look at verse 14 again. Your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should perish. Pastoral care matters. The whole point of Jesus' parable was to show to the disciples, look at the Father's heart. Look how he pursues. Look how he goes after his sheep. Emulate your Father's heart. And I don't know what you think of or what springs to mind when you think about pastoral care. Whether you think of the pastor who goes out to visit someone who's in a particular difficult time of their life. And praise God for our elders, and pray for them at this time as they model to us the attitude of caring for individuals. But listen, Jesus is saying to us in this passage that we are all involved in pastoral care. Remember who Jesus is speaking to, his disciples. And we need to hear, as his disciples, at this particular time in the life of the church, what Jesus is saying to us. I mean, the truth is we are in an utterly unusual context as a church. And the devil will no doubt be scheming and seeking every opportunity to use this for evil, to undermine fellowship, to cause people to stumble, to cause people to consider wandering away. And just like the coronavirus, some of us in this struggle will show those symptoms really obviously, and some of us, it will barely be visible. Will we emulate the Father's heart at this time to pursue with care and love those around us, especially when we see them struggling? And if you think that just sounds too overwhelming, and if you think I'm not qualified for that, I'm not the pastor, I haven't had the training for that, you realize what you're doing in pastoral care. You're giving people Jesus. You are pointing people to him. We are not the real shepherd. To leave the world of sheep behind for a moment, we are like the person in a tour group who sees someone wandering off and brings them back to the group and ultimately to the guide. Pastoral care is pointing people to, giving people the good shepherd Jesus. When they are doubting, point them to his cross where he has proven his unconditional love for them. When they are scared, point them to his empty tomb where he has cured their greatest illness and their greatest enemy. When they are fed up, point them to his satisfaction as the bread of life for them to feed on. Give them Jesus. Let's pray together. Father God, we acknowledge that this may feel like a strange and unsettling time for our church, as lots of things are changing. But also, Lord, we want to anticipate that this is a time where we might know in a deepness that we have never experienced before relationships with one another. Father, please, at the heart of our attitudes and our relationships with each other, please will you help us to have your heart in everything that we do. For your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing your grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Songs of God's abundant treasure, sung by angel tongues above. Songs that tell the boundless measure of my Lord's unchanging love. I remember God's great mercy, by his help I've safely come, and I know he will not fail me, but will surely bring me home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering far away from God, and to rescue me from danger, shed for me his precious blood. God's grace, I am his debtor. Daily I this thought renew. Let that grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to you. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Take my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal steal it from your courts above.